finally tonight, an exhibition of new American art, some of it most unusual. Paul Solman of WGBH Boston reports.
Since it's 1997, it's time for another Whitney Biennial. For the past 2 years, the Whitney Museum of American Art has been scouring galleries and studios across the United States and looking at thousands of slides, trying to select what it would showcase as the most significant work done in American art since 1995. The show tends to get plenty of notice and criticism, often for the biennial's overall vision. Too political. Too cerebral. Too worried about what's hot and what's not. But that's not what we were doing here. Our purpose was to take in the show on its own terms and give you a sense of the work here, including some stuff you don't usually see on the NewsHour. The theme of the biennial this time around is narrative. So we simply went looking for stories, hoping to let a few of them and the artist's storytellers speak for themselves. Sure enough, there were stories galore at the Whitney, as well as electronic music in the elevator to take you to them. Now, one set of stories seemed mainly political. Kara Walker's brutal images of the days of slavery, for instance. Kerry James Marshall's story is about the American dream, and folks for whom it seems more nearly a cruel illusion. The bluebird of happiness flying over an inner-city housing project, for example. Neither of these artists was in town the day we shot, but Zoe Leonard was, and her photographs also told a political tale.
It's the archive of the life of a fictional character, a woman named Faye Richards, who, had she really lived, would have been born in 1908 and basically got into film when she was pretty young. She played maids and mammies in a bunch of Hollywood films. And then at a certain point in her life, became really frustrated with the racism in Hollywood, left Hollywood, and began to work in race films in black Hollywood throughout the later part of her life.
Real-life actress Lisa Marie Bronson posed as the fake Faye Richards. The nub of the project, conceptual.
It's about the idea that history isn't something that's always told completely. It's always told by certain people at certain times. And women like Faye Richards, even if they really lived, their histories aren't recorded. We know so little about black actresses of that time. So in a way, Faye is a stand-in for all the women we don't know about. She could have been the black Dietrich, but there wasn't room for that in our world back then.
So in other words, for me to really appreciate what you're trying to do, you hook me in with a narrative, a story. Mm-hmm. You then layer it with these intimations of history.
Yes. People come in, and I've watched people look at the piece, and they get really curious. And then they're like, wait a minute, is she real? Is she not real? Does she exist? And then they start asking themselves the questions that I want them to be asking about her life.
Okay, so much for political stories. And on to our second stop, ladies' lingerie. Well, not really. Let's call this next group of stories esoteric, given their extremely private frames of reference. Louise Bourgeois, for instance, a well-known artist in her 80s, calls up, it was explained to us, images from her youth. Gabriel Orozco works with more current imagery, bits and pieces of the contemporary world around us, Dannon yogurt tops, Yardley soap boxes, and so on. More privately meaningful, or if you prefer, mysterious, Diana Fater's installation, Electric Mind. And utterly internal, Annette Lawrence's spiral of dates, barely distinguishable one from the other. It turns out the dates are those of her menstrual cycle, the smudges painted with, well, the effluvium of same. The title, Moons. Perhaps the most esoteric work of all, though, the paintings of Matthew Ritchie. The story here, trimmed to save time, seven fallen angels, known as Watchers, represent these seven parts of the brain, thus uniting myth and science as joint creators of our universe.
This painting, which is called The Binding Problem, shows the seven characters, the Watchers, who collectively embody the seven gross parts of the human brain in my mythology. And what's happening here is they've left this kind of reef you can see here, and they're falling. And as they move below the horizon, they're trying to communicate with each other by sort of disintegrating and exchanging body parts. And they're failing. It's very sad.
I mean, you find it sad?
Yeah, it's a very sad part of the story.
Sad, perhaps. Detailed, definitely. For instance, one shape relates to red blood cells spilling out of it, which in turn relate to a red shape representing the medulla of the brain, which relates to little embryonic forms of one of the seven characters related to an earlier incarnation of the medulla, sort of parented by another fellow, the angel for iron, which is hemoglobin, the principal element of blood. Richie gives background for all of this in cyberspace with a site on the World Wide Web. But suppose you don't want to invest that kind of time. Would you still get it?
Well, first off, I mean, this is not a test. This is art, you know. And if you go into something like the Sistine Chapel, you see all these characters and angels and guys with wings, and it's all going on. And it's another language. And you don't feel obliged because you're there that you have to figure it all out. And I would hope that people could approach this the same way.
Okay, on to a third set of stories that we'd categorize, for want of a better rubric, as primarily playful. Glenn Cedar's tilted replica of the Whitney director's old office, for example. Here, the joke was on me. This exhibit actually made me queasy. Jennifer Pastor was one of several artists to play with ideas of scale in her work, The Four Seasons. Ryan Crockett's Ignis Fatuus looked like an exploded intestine, or maybe a balloon sculpture from a kid's birthday party, and seemed playfully inviting. One exhibit insisted on touch. Charles Long's clay clump, designed to bring out the Michelangelo or Jim Henson in almost everyone, with music provided by Stereolab to soothe or stir the savage breast. But the installation that really caught our eye was this one.
I opened her coffin. She wasn't quite dead. So I took a bazooka and blew off her head.
How, I asked artist Tony Ausler, would he advise our audience to experience his work?
Just take a look, you know, because these things are designed to be kind of one half of a conversation. And the viewer is envisioned as the other half of the conversation.
Ausler's part of the dialogue is subversive children's rhymes, an attempt to trigger the subversive child in the viewer.
I hate you, you hate me. I got a machine gun to kill Barney. One big shot, Barney's on the floor.
This is Barney the PBS puppet, right?
Yeah, the puppet. So then there you have, you know, these kids kind of figuring out different ways to kill this thing that's being shoved down their throat, you know, as a kind of corporate package.
Pull the trigger. Hit him in the head. Oopsie-daisy, Barney's dead.
Ausler says he wants to break the hypnotic trance of commercial culture, even on non-commercial TV, with something subversive that asks viewers to participate.
These particular texts are, they're not exactly childish, you know, they're actually kind of intense and violent, sexual. So that was kind of the idea with these heads, kind of detached heads in a way, kind of echoing to one another through time and space, different variations on these poems.
As you can see, Ausler answered my oh-so-serious questions with serious answers. But he thought I was missing the essential fun of it all. So I played along in a demonstration of his craft. First, he videotapes a face within a black frame.
When I'm looking at your exhibit, what do you expect me to be doing?
I read a statistic once that the average museum goer spends about 1.5 seconds in front of each painting.
Then he plays back the tape onto a molded head.
People will spend 2 hours in a Hollywood movie that you could sum up in 10 seconds. So I think it's a matter of priorities and a different way of looking at time, really.
Yeah, but movies have a vocabulary, a set of conventions that we're already familiar with, whereas with new artists and works of art, you've got to, as an act of faith, learn their vocabulary, enter into their worlds, and you don't know what the payoff's going to be.
I disagree. I think that most Hollywood movies induce in the viewer a hypnagogic trance, a drug-like state, and that culturally art might be difficult in the beginning, but eventually it's a lot more playful experience than I think you're letting on.
If you had to state a sort of overall purpose for your work, would you say it's to break the hypnotic trance that we're in as a result of this culture?
That would be good if the Whitney Biennial could do that.
This answer of Tony Auerschler's brought us back to the Biennial for one last concern. When we were at the Whitney, we'd had to leave some of our TV gear alone for much of the day. Some museum-goers had taken to contemplating it as yet another exhibit. In the spirit of the show, a nearby guard answered their questions.
Is that a piece of artwork? I says, yes, it is. What is the title? I says, it's on title.
Over the years, critics of modern art have put forth such instances as evidence that aesthetic judgment has become random. But Tony Auerschler had a completely different response.
I love that story. I mean, it's just incredible if people could have that, take that attitude with them out of the museum into their daily lives.
You mean they could look at the world as if it were all art?
For a time, anyway.
Everything is art. Pop art made that point back in the 1960s. But it's not the main point of this Whitney Biennial, which is, as we've said, about stories. Playful ones, political ones, esoteric ones. Most of them, of course, we simply don't have time for, so we've shown you a small sample of the exhibition, which in the final analysis is in turn only a tiny sample of American art done in the last 2 years.